By the 1880s, things kind of slowed down around Deadwood. I went up north, started a little ranch, raised horses and cattle, and eventually helped lay out the little town of Belle Fouche. It was there that I was to meet a man who'd have a tremendous amount of influence on me and, well, on the entire country. I was out riding the range looking for strays one day, and I came across what appeared to me to be a couple of suspicious-looking tin-horn gamblers or cattle rustlers. Well, little did I know, I was about to meet a gentleman by the name of Theodore Roosevelt. He was a deputy sheriff of Billings County, bringing a horse thief down to me in Deadwood. Over the years, we became great friends. We shared a tremendous love for the western wilderness. Well, later on, when he was president, he appointed me as the first forest supervisor of the Black Hills Reserve, a post I held proudly for many, many years. Well, we became such good friends, he stuck his boys on the train clear out in Washington, D.C., sent them all the way out to me here in Deadwood. I took them up in the hills and we did a little hunting and fishing. Took them out on the ranch and did a little roping and riding, western style, of course. I even got to accompany Theodore to England. Quite an honor. Even got to meet the Queen. At the reception at Buckingham Palace, this English fella comes up to me and he says, "I say, Mr. Bullock," they say that all the time, "I say, Mr. Bullock, your President Roosevelt doesn't seem to think too much of our kings and queens." Well, I thought for a minute and I said, "You know, I think he prefers aces." "Jolly good, Mr. Bullock, jolly good," they say that all the time. Now, you're probably aware of this, but when Theodore was running for vice president, he was not at all popular out west here. He was, in fact, so unpopular that a lot of his political rallies ended up as riots. He enlisted my assistance with a particularly rowdy bunch up in Butte, Montana. I did still have some influence in the Montana area. The rally was to be held there at the Opera House in Butte, of course. As we convened for the speeches, I positioned myself directly behind Theodore on the stage, a gun on each hip, arms folded, staring out into the crowd. Well, as he began to speak, I'd fix my gaze on any portion of the audience that let out so much as a whisper. Well, when he finished, of course he gave a dandy speech, he turned around to me and said, "Seth, I held that audience rather well, didn't I? Not one interruption." Never did have the heart to tell him I'd send around word if anybody so much as peeked and shoot him. Now, when Theodore was elected president, I thought some of us should be there to represent the West that he loved so much. I rounded up 50 cowboys. We all took the train to Washington, D.C. On Inauguration Day, we rode down Pennsylvania Avenue, creating considerable excitement, roping the occasional pedestrian. Of course, all the boys wore six shooters. They couldn't resist firing off a shot or two in the air. Theodore loved it, but the Secret Service boys, you can only imagine. Theodore Roosevelt died in 1919. Every day the wind blows across the memorial we built for him up on the hill over here. He loved the West, people who lived here, people whose spirits were carved by the land and tied to the seasons. I died later that same year. I'm buried up on Mount Moriah here. Years ago, I could look across the gulch and see Theodore's memorial, but now the trees have grown up so I can still hear his voice when the wind blows.